Welcome to Union Presbyterian Church service online for this Sunday, August the 22nd, 2021. Well, hello again. So, how are you hanging in just when we thought we had turned that final corner and now we find ourselves in the position where we better not put our old surfboards away yet because there's a fourth wave coming, and it looks like we're right in it. But I want to assure you this morning that the promise made long, long ago by God Himself is still true today. The eternal God is your refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms. Now that's comforting, isn't it? So, if you think you're sinking, if you feel you're out of your depth, if you feel you just can't tread water any longer, remember God's promises. God is able to bless you abundantly, so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. That's also from the Word of God. So yes, God is able. The only problem is, do you believe it? Well, let's ask God to help us as we go to Him now in prayer. Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, we do come to You today in all of our weaknesses, with all of our needs. But Lord, we want to sort of set them aside right now, and we want to say thank You, O God, for being our Father. Thank You that You are able to meet our needs, that You are strong, that You know what's happening in our lives, and You've promised that You'll help us to get through these tough times. You've promised us that underneath and round about us are the everlasting arms of a Father who will always catch us, never let us go. We may stumble, yes, but Lord, You will always be there. You will never leave us. You will never forsake us. You have promised. We thank You, Father, this morning for Your holy word, the Bible that never changes. The message is the same today as it was thousands of years ago. And it's amazing to us to think that our needs are still the same, our wants and desires, our natures are still the same. We haven't changed much in that way, but so much more has changed. And Lord, just recently in our lives, this has come to pass, and You know how overwhelming it is for us. But we are quite aware today, O Father, that there are those in this world around us who are suffering, who are in situations far, far greater, far more serious, far more drastic and threatening than anything we face today or perhaps have ever faced in our lifetime. And so, Father, today we pray for the people of Afghanistan. We pray today for the people of Haiti. We pray today, Father, for all of those around us who are suffering the effects of the pandemic and are in fear. Lord, we pray that You'll give them confidence in knowing that You're going to get them through this. You're not going to let them down. Lord, we pray that You'll help us to think of others, to pray for others, to be aware of the needs around us. And we've found in our lifetime that when we do that, we tend to not concentrate so much on ourselves and our own problems. They don't go away, but they just don't seem as big. And so thank You, Father, that you've taught us in everything to give thanks, for this is Your will in us who are in Christ Jesus. And so today, Father, as Your family, we come to You with all of our families, and we ask you'll bless us, You'll keep us in touch with You. Father, You'll help us to be aware that You are right there for us, and help us not to shove You aside and just call upon You when we get desperate, that we pray, Father, that you'll help us to make you the foundation, the cornerstone of every day of our lives. And now, Father, together as your family, help us to pray the prayer Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we have forgiven those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Our opening hymn today is Holy, 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 and the singer once again is Steve Green. Please listen and be blessed. My sermon text today is several related passages from Paul's letter to the Romans. So I'll be reading from, and I hope you'll read with me, from chapter 1, verses 18 to 22, then verse 25, verses 28 to 32, and then chapter 2, the first four verses. Let us read together. The wrath of God is being revealed from heaven against all the godlessness and wickedness of people who suppress the truth by their wickedness. Since what may be known about God is plain to them, because God has made it plain to them. For since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made. For although they knew God, they neither glorified him as God nor gave thanks to him, but their thinking became futile and their foolish hearts were darkened. Although they claimed to be wise, they became fools. They exchanged the truth about God for a lie and worshipped and served created things rather than the Creator, who is forever praised. Amen. Furthermore, just as they did not think it worthwhile to retain the knowledge of God, so God gave them over to a depraved mind, so that they do what they ought not to be done, what not ought to be done. They have become filled with every kind of wickedness, evil, greed, and depravity. They are full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, and malice. They are gossips, slanderers, God-haters, insolent, arrogant, and boastful. They invent ways of doing evil. They disobey their parents. They have no understanding, no fidelity, no love, no mercy. Although they know God's righteous decree that those who do such things deserve death, they not only continue to do these very things, but also approve of those who practice them. You, therefore, have no excuse, you who pass judgment on someone else. For at whatever point you judge another, you are condemning yourself, because you who pass judgment do the same things. Now we know that God's judgment against those who do such things is based on truth. So when you, a mere human being, pass judgment on them and yet do the same things, do you think you will escape God's judgment? Or do you show contempt for the riches of his kindness, forbearance and patience, not realizing that God's kindness is intended to lead you to repentance? May God bless his word this morning and give the preacher help in presenting it to you. We have a second hymn this morning, once again by our friend Steve Green, and I hope you will enjoy it. It's called He Who Began a Good Work in You. It's a hymn that's going to just encourage you, and I hope you will really enjoy it.
He who began a good work in to complete.
This is part three of my sermon series on Romans called Staying Faithful Through Tough Times. Back again. I guess we're all the same. We all tend to think that what's happening in the world around us is new, that somehow, surely, no one who has lived before us has been forced to face what we are facing today. Now, of course, that's not at all true. But I think you might agree that previous generations sort of had a break because they didn't have a clue what was happening on the other side of the world. It took days, weeks to hear what by that time was now history. For us, we hear and see it all, and it makes things tougher. Thanks to modern technology, we don't miss a thing. And we get it in full color as well. So what is it that we are hearing and seeing today? Well, it's not good this week, is it? In Haiti, a devastating major earthquake, followed almost immediately by a devastating tropical storm. Thousands dead, and many more thousands seriously hurt, and the whole country facing pending starvation. Chaos in Afghanistan, mostly due to astonishingly poor planning of an American military exit strategy. So sad. Over 37 million souls in Afghanistan, did you know that? Around the same as Canada, a little more. Over 37 million souls are feeling abandoned after having felt relatively safe for about the past 20 years. Now, because of an amazingly small number of jihadists, they're hiding in their homes, afraid to venture outside, and especially the women. Ladies, can you imagine what it would be like for you? And what of their future? Indeed, what of the future of a world threatened by terrorists whose avowed aim is to force not only their religion but their law on the rest of the world? But that's nonsense, right? That'll never happen. Well, your opinion is as good as mine, but I think we can all agree that things indeed are going to be tense for a good long while to come. We'll have to wait and see. And in the meantime, what are the things that most concern us living here in good old Canada? Well, a federal election, right smack in the middle of the fourth wave of a pandemic. Go figure. And oh yes, everyone, especially preachers, it seems nowadays, walking on eggshells and afraid of hurting someone's feelings by simply telling the truth. The Bible tells us to speak the truth, but to do it in love. That's hard to do. So here I go, speaking the truth, and I hope I do it in love. But the truth I'm speaking today is not my opinions, and nothing according to me, but according to the Word of God. And as we look at our text this morning a little closer, we'll see that the truth has not changed over the past millenniums. What God said was true back then is still true today. Back in the early days of space travel in the 1960s, we were all glued to the television set, remember? Watching the announcer do the countdown. Nowadays, most people ignore rocket launchings. It seems there are so many of them recently. But if you're like me back then, you joined in. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, ignition, liftoff! And we watched the rocket slowly soar into the heavens. Well, today I have another countdown for you. 10 things that the Apostle Paul gives us from our text today. He starts with something that we do not want to hear. But as we look around us today, it's something that I think we simply cannot ignore. Here it is. 1. The wrath of God is being revealed. That's what our text says. Now, I'm not one of those so-called prophecy preachers who write books and go on TV telling people that the world is coming to an end next week. Let them go ahead. They've all made assumptions, called them prophecies. They've seen them fail to happen, and then unapologetically, they just go on making more prophecies and churning out more books and putting more money in the bank. Am I cynical? You betcha, I am. But having said that, the prophecy by Paul in the letter to the Romans, written almost 2,000 years ago, was true back then, and it's just as true right now. The point is, God is not a bully out to hurt people. Just jump ahead to the end of today's text, the last verse we read. What does it say? God's kindness, forbearance, and patience is intended to lead us to repentance. This kindness and forbearance and patience has been going on for thousands of years. And it will continue until God says so. You know what? That's good enough for me. I don't make prophecies. 2. Although they knew God, they neither glorified him as God nor gave thanks to him. When the famous British writer and former atheist C.S. Lewis, one of my favorite writers, when he first gave his life to Jesus, he initially resisted praising God. In fact, he called it a stumbling block. His struggle was in the suggestion that God himself demanded it. Yet, Lewis finally realized that it is in the process of being worshipped that God communicates his presence to his people. Then we, in perfect love with God, find joy in him, no more separable than the brightness a mirror receives from the brightness it sheds. Profound thought. C.S. Lewis realized the whole world rings with his praise. As we give praise to God, come into his presence, then he becomes real to us. So maybe we need to do less complaining and more praising. At least I know I need to. For us, haven't you found, as I have found as well, that being thankful to God for the things you've still got is a lot better than worrying about the things that you have lost. And I hope I'm hearing you say amen to this. 3. Although they claimed to be wise, Paul says, they became fools. A wise man learns by the experience of others, right? An ordinary man learns by his own experience. A fool learns by nobody's experience. The so-called wisdom and the blatant foolishness of mankind can be summed up completely in one of the mantras that we've heard from the rioters in recent times, over and over again. Defund the police! You know what? Every social worker I know, and I know a few, Every social worker I know is shaking in their boots. You want me to do what? 4. They exchanged the truth about God for a lie. Here, the words of an old Gloria Gaither song come to mind. There have been times of affluence and prosperity when the church's message was nearly diluted into oblivion by those who sought to make it socially attractive, neatly organized, and financially profitable. It has been gold-plated, draped in purple, and encrusted with jewels. It has been misrepresented, ridiculed, blotted, and scorned. These followers of Jesus Christ have been, according to the whim of the times, elevated as secret leaders and martyred as heretics. Yet through it all, there marches on that powerful army of the meek, God's chosen people who cannot be bought, flattered, murdered, or stilled. On through the ages they march, the church, God's church triumphant, alive and well. You're going to find the church, the truth, preached at Union Church unapologetically, but wisely, I hope, and all the time lovingly. No lies. 5. He goes on to say, and worshipped and served created things rather than the Creator. Now surely the indictment against our generation and our parents, perhaps our grandparents too, I'm not sure, is that, as someone has said, we worship our work, work at our play, and play at our worship. Enough said. 6. He says, furthermore, just as they did not think it worthwhile to retain the knowledge of God, so God gave them over to a depraved mind. I wonder when those in authority over us will learn that they cannot legislate behavior. They cannot legislate our attitudes and our thoughts. You cannot legislate morality. And anyway, let's face it, they don't know what morality is anymore. It's whatever the vocal minority wants it to be, it seems. And that's why God is leaving us alone and has for such a long time. But be very sure, there is a day of reckoning coming. The Apostle Peter tells us, do not forget this one thing, dear friends. With the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like a day. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief. The heavens will disappear with a roar. The elements will be destroyed by fire, and the earth and everything done in it will be laid bare. Oh, solemn words. But now, the camera lens is turned inwards. And now comes the selfie, if you like. Up to this point, it's been easy to point the finger at the other person with the attitude, boy, are you in trouble. But now listen to what Paul says as the finger is pointed in the other direction. 7. You, therefore, have no excuse, you who pass judgment on someone else. For at whatever point you judge another, you are condemning yourself, because you who pass judgment do the same things. Now, wait a minute. That's not true. Really? Hey, you know what? This hurts me just as much as it hurts you. Did you ever wonder why Jesus said, "Why do you look at the speck of sawdust in your brother's eye and pay no attention to the plank in your own eye? How can you say to your brother, 'Let me take the speck out of your eye,' when all the time there's a plank in your own eye? You hypocrite! First take the plank out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye." I don't need to comment on that. Think about the words of Jesus. They do not apply to somebody else. They apply to me, and they apply to you. 8. Now we know that God's judgment against those who do such things is based on truth. Well, there it is. End of discussion. God does not lie, as the letter to Titus says. But we do, and we do it easily. We do it when it's convenient, or when we tell ourselves it's necessary. But God is truth. Thankfully, He is also the personification of love. 9. So when you, a mere human being, pass judgment on them, and yet do the same things, do you think you will escape God's judgment? Now, here's something that I have never preached about in all my years at Union Church, but I will when we get to Romans chapter 14. I'm not sure exactly when that will be. For now, let me just give you the scripture reference. It's a sobering truth. You then, why do you judge your brother or sister? Or why do you treat them with contempt? For we will all stand before God's judgment seat. So then, each of us will give an account of ourselves to God. I don't want to preach about that, but I will. 10. He says, do you show contempt for the riches of his kindness, forbearance, and patience, not realizing that God's kindness is intended to lead you to repentance? So the countdown is over. We now have liftoff. Repentance. We've heard that word before, and here it is again. That's the word that's becoming obsolete in our world today, along with the word commitment. Nobody is sorry for anything, and nobody wants to change the way they are. Nobody wants to be tied down to anything or anyone. I know those are strong statements. But listen again to the Apostle Paul quoted in Acts chapter 20. I have had one message for Jews and Greeks alike, the necessity of repenting from sin and turning to God and of having faith in our Lord Jesus. Now, of course, he meant that the message is the same for the whole world, without exception. Here's the truth. God's kindness is intended to lead you and me to repentance. Repentance means changing direction, turning in God's direction, getting real, and living real. Surely, if there is one thing that we all have learned in the past 2 years, it's that our former life in fantasy land is coming to an end. So, dear friends, let's get real with God. Amen. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you safe. May his light shine on you, and may it shine forth from within you, and may you be a blessing to everyone you meet this week. And Lord willing, I'll see you again next week. Until then, once again, let's close today by singing together, "Go Now in Peace." May peace, faith, and love fill your hearts this week. Bye. Goodbye for now.